the pod bay doors, please, Hal.
This is great! He fired her! This is incredible! He fired her! I'm out, baby! I'm out!
Why'd he fire her?
Because I kissed her in the meeting! Russell found out, he fired her over the phone! Finally, my stupidity pays off!
What is? Here come the judge! Here come the judge!
You can't break up with her now. Her life is shattered. You got her fired. You got to be there for her.
What? You got to at least wait until she gets another job.
Another job?
Couple of interviews.
Oh, this is unbelievable. I'm stuck. Every time I think I'm out, they pull me back in.
The pod bay doors are open. Welcome once again. I'm your host, Jerry Dean Roberts of ArmchairCinema.com and also ArmchairOscars.com. Here with my partner in crime, the critic, dare I say, legend, or talkmoviemedia.com, the one and only Mr. Doug Heller. How are you, Paizan?
I command this family, right or wrong!
It was not what I wanted!
It was not what I wanted!
Was this the beginning of Screaming Pacino?
This is near the beginning of Screaming Pacino. I believe Screaming Pacino started around Sea of Love in 88 or 89. Because he took a big break from film acting in the 80s. Revolution was so bad that even his name couldn't bring money to it. So he dropped out for a while, and then when he came back with Sea of Love, he started the shouting!
Oh, he had a rough time. Like, the 70s were his golden age. Mm-hmm. Like, he had done The Godfather, and he had done The Dog Day Afternoon, and that kind of stuff.
Serpico.
And even Panic in Needle Park, which I love.
Yeah,
and
that was good.
And then in the 80s, it was like, I think, beginning with Cruising. It was like Cruising and Author, remember that?
I do remember Author.
And then some people like Scarface, I don't.
I don't like Scarface. I have actually seen the movie that drove him from film.
Mm-hmm.
It's called Revolution. And it is appallingly bad.
Yeah.
I don't know if I would even be able to find it again to do it for Turkey Month.
That's probably best. Yeah. Usually movies like that are streaming free on YouTube.
Yeah. Have you seen that one?
I have seen that one.
Yeah, it's terrible.
So years ago.
Yeah.
Awesome. We're talking today about a sort of an unusual thing. Well, not really that unusual, because Coppola is very good about going back and re-editing stuff, because he did this with
He's done that once
Apocalypse
or twice.
Now.
Yeah.
He did this with Apocalypse Now, and he did this with Cotton Club.
He did this with Apocalypse Now like three times.
He's got two more before he catches up with Blade Runner, though.
Yeah, that's true.
He's re-edited that. He re-edited the Cotton Club,
Which I still need to watch.
It's all right. The Cotton Club is okay.
I liked the original. You know, version of it. I still have to watch the recut.
But the man is an auteur.
Mm-hmm.
You know, till the day he dies, and generally has no patience for the studio system. Unfortunately, the studio system, I think, is really one of the things that's to blame for the movie we're talking about today, which we're going to talk about The Godfather Coda, but we're also going to talk about a little bit about The Godfather Part III. I do consider them sort of separate, because Coda is basically a re-edit of Part III, in which he has rearranged some scenes. He's tightened it up. And unfortunately, has added an ending that I still don't understand.
I don't get it. I don't get.
Yeah.
The we'll get to that. But the beginning, the first two thirds of this recut are solid.
Yeah.
Like a vast improvement, and I like The Godfather Part III well enough. We've talked about this before. I saw it before I knew the general feeling toward it. So I didn't have the negativity going into it. So I just watched it and liked it. Sofia Coppola could not act her way out of a wet paper bag.
That's obvious. That's still obvious. Nothing in her performance has changed.
Nothing has gotten better.
It has not improved with age.
It's gotten worse.
Yeah. Particularly when you know the history of this role.
Yeah. Yeah. But as soon as they get to Sicily, it just falls apart. It begins meandering, and it goes back to just not really having much of a focus.
I drop out about the time of that shootout in the penthouse. The helicopter.
Oh, see, I love that.
See, I'll get to that in a bit, but let's talk about the changes, because what he's done is, in the original, in The Godfather Part III, it opened it was kind of disjointed, so that you actually got to the main plot about a half an hour into the movie.
Yeah.
So the movie opened originally with the remains of the estate of Tahoe.
Yeah, the Tahoe compound. And yeah.
Which, it's always a bad idea to open your movie with a shot of a plunger, but that's a different issue.
It did set the stage for the movie, though. It did set the tone.
I guess it was supposed to symbolize the crumbling of his criminal empire. But he's writing a letter to his children, coming to this papal order. I don't have any idea what this papal order is that he's becoming a part of, but they make a big deal out of it.
Well, okay, so basically, it's like a very high honor in the church. He's being recognized by the Pope for being, I don't know, a good Catholic. But really, he's being recognized because he gave, what, $800 million to the Vatican Bank? Which you find,
but you don't know that
you don't know that yet. But I love in the recut they put that is the first scene, and it actually follows with the openings of The Godfather and The Godfather Part II, the way that they open really quietly with a meeting. They always opened with a meeting, and three decided to just go with something completely different. And it was like sitting in the theater watching Attack of the Clones and having the camera pan up after the scroll went instead of panning down. It's like, wait, what?
Well, in the original, it opens with the remains of Tahoe, and then he's writing a letter to the children, and then you go to the ceremony, and then the after party, and then the meeting with Bishop Gilday.
Right.
The coda opens with the meeting with Bishop Gilday, then goes to the letter inviting them to the ceremony, then the after party, because they cut the ceremony.
Yeah.
And then we go into the story. What this does is it gets you involved in what the story is supposed to be about, which is him basically buying his absolution.
Right.
You know, $500 million that he's going to donate to the Vatican Bank.
It's a very 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 expensive what were they called in indulgence,
international immobiliari.
Yeah, indulgence.
Indulgence.
The,
yeah.
The Catholic Church used to sell forgiveness. Used to sell little and so that's kind of a it's a very expensive indulgence.
Right. And the movie, and tightening up the movie and rearranging those scenes gets you into the story faster. It gets Vincent into the story a lot faster. I still have issues with that scene at the after party because as I'm sitting there watching it the other night, I'm just like, there's a whole lot of so what in this opening scene because they're trying to do a lot of reunion stuff.
Yeah.
You know, they're trying to bring Johnny Fontaine in.
Yeah.
And they bring in the bridesmaid.
Susie,
Susie, who gets one line.
Yeah.
Vincent, we're not on the list.
And it was that actress.
Was, It was that actress. She gets the one line, and then we're introduced to the fact that Vincent is her son by Sonny.
Mm-hmm.
And then he comes into the movie. But still, it always feels a little awkward because it feels like this reunion that's just, it's kind of not set up very well.
Yeah, no.
And the way that it plays out is almost like Connie is trying to keep things lively, but they're not very lively, and it's just...
Yeah, I had I had difficulty with the introduction of Don Altobello as a character that has been there the whole time.
Yeah.
It's like, well, wait a minute. When did I miss? Was he in the other? Like, when I first saw this, I'm like, well, who the hell is he? I didn't see him in the other two. Mm-hmm. How is he like this old family friend and he doesn't show up for anything? He's Connie's godfather, villain? And it's Eli Wallach, which, I mean, I love Eli Wallach to the ends of the earth.
But he's not Italian.
He's not Italian. He did not belong here.
Well, the other two Godfather movies, the villains were so colorful, and you felt the weight of their presence. You know, you at least felt some kind of, you know, remember Virgil Salazzo when he comes in, he's a very serious man, mm-hmm. and he's, you know, you can tell he's kind of a bulldog. He's got that pimp hat,
yeah.
you know, and he comes in and you can tell this is a dangerous guy,
mm-hmm.
you know, and here it's Eli Wallach playing a character who's got to be in his mid-80s.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just like, he's such a weak character. There's no strength to this character at all.
Right, and he's set up like this great big mastermind, but when he's on screen, it does not... What we're given...
He kind of withers.
Yeah, what we're given is not what we're told.
Right.
We're told a lot more about him than we see, and it doesn't quite gel.
There is another guy behind the curtain. That's the Lucchese, but he's such a small part of this movie, and he's one scene.
Yeah.
Late in the film, and this is the guy behind the curtain, and you're like, okay, who is this guy?
Right. There's no development of this. There's a lot of mention of this overarching threat to the church and...
Mm-hmm.
What this company is and does and how it all works. And, you know, after Michael has his stroke, Lucchese said, you know, if he dies, everything's out in the open.
Yeah.
Like, this can't happen. I wanted more stuff with that. Like, I didn't care about Joey Zaza. It got to a point where it was like the street mafia stuff wasn't interesting anymore. That's why mm-hmm. they're moving on in the movie. That's why Michael's moving on. Because it's just not a viable thing for them anymore. And it stopped being a viable story for this character.
It's just not interesting.
Yeah.
There's nothing going on with this character. Once this character is out of the story, there's not really a massive impact. The only thing that he has, he's a street thug who's basically let the old neighborhood go to pot.
Yeah. I mean, Joe Montana is very good in the role.
Yeah, he is very good in the role, although it's kind of cartoonish.
It is.
You know, when he goes to leave that meeting, he's like, I have been insulted this day.
Yeah.
You know, he sounds like Fat Tony on The Simpsons.
Yeah, yeah, he does.
You know,
he does. It's a little much, and it's the whole presenting him with the Italian American,
the Meucci Award.
Yeah, the Meucci Award. Who the guy, the Italian American who invented the telephone 1 year.
Who the hell is Meucci?
Well, that's what Michael says.
Yeah, this is Michael. Who the hell is Meucci?
That was Meucci. Well, that
but, was it. Honestly, it's like all the new characters. There's just this so what character. It's just a so what because.
And
for every minute, you can feel that this was a movie Coppola did not want to make.
Yeah. And like
he wanted to end it with two.
There's a story here, but they don't tell it.
Right.
And that's the tragedy. I wanted to see the dirty underbelly of the Catholic Church. And this promises to dig into that, and it just never does.
Right.
It only scratches the surface. And that's where the story is. That's where the interesting story is. That and Michael and Kay. I love their stuff in Sicily when he takes her on that drive is the best part of the last act of the movie.
Yeah. But I also like the scene at the beginning when she's in his office.
Yeah.
And she just comes in. I think that was a disgraceful. That was a disgrace out there what you did, you know. She knows who he is.
Yeah.
And she'll come in and she'll tell him who he is. It's like we know. And by the way,
that must have been a really expensive gift medal from the Pope.
By the way, we know what you did to Fredo.
Yeah.
You know? But again, this is a movie Coppola did not want to make, and he Paramount Pictures left the door open for him for 16 years.
Yeah.
And while they dangled it in front of a lot of other directors who wouldn't take it, and he finally had to take it because of the financial failure of, I think, One from the Heart and then the Cotton Club.
One from the Heart, Cotton Club, Rumblefish, Tucker the Man and His Dream was the one that he did just before this one. All of those... like the 80s failed for Francis Ford Coppola.
Gardens of Stone.
Yeah. The 80s basically failed for him. He was the king of the 70s and the fool of the 80s.
Yeah.
Could not get a hit picture to save his life.
Mm-hmm.
And so he did this and he got nominated for a bunch of Oscars for it.
Lost all of them.
Yeah.
But
and justifiably so. Yes. I don't know. Like
what I hear is that it was Paramount was basically gonna go ahead with this movie with or without him.
Yeah.
Because he kept refusing it. And he kept rejecting it. And finally, he had to say yes because he was having financial problems.
Right.
And he did
which is a common refrain in Francis Ford Coppola's professional career.
He didn't want to do this. He wanted to do it as a coda. He wanted to call it The Death of Michael Corleone.
But he had no clout, so he couldn't. It was funny, in the commentary for The Godfather Part III on the DVDs, now I'm talking the 2001 initial DVD edition commentary.
Is that the box set?
Yeah, the original box set way back from 2001.
Mm-hmm.
Coppola said at the beginning of The Godfather Part III, he said, the title of this is... He basically said that it's the indication of how his power had faltered between 2 and 3. He said when 2 was coming out, they wanted a subtitle. And because that was what everybody did. And I refused and I said, no, it has to be just part 2. And I had the clout to make them do that. And he said, then come around to this one. Where they said, we want to make it part 3. And he goes, I want to call it The Death of Michael Corleone. And it's part three because I had no power. Like he notes that power shift that he got to name two what he wanted, but not three.
Yeah. Well, he also just made one of the most successful movies of all time. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. He just made an artistic triumph with The Godfather.
A commercial and, artistic triumph.
That movie won the Oscar, I think, on a Monday.
Yeah.
And on a Friday, they greenlit the second one. And, I mean, it took no time for them to greenlight it. And the second one turned out to be an even bigger triumph than the first one. Mm-hmm. And, of course, I come from a weird place because The Godfather is my favorite movie ever made.
Right.
Just ever. But you come to this movie and almost, I don't know, I have a very difficult time connecting this with the other two films in a lot of ways. And I think the biggest problem, one of the biggest problems, even bigger than Sophia, is there is a hole in the middle of this movie where Robert Duvall should be.
Yeah.
Because this should be... the pull that Michael is going through and a lot of the things he's going through, there needs to be the voice of reason.
Mm-hmm.
And that should be Duvall, and he's not there.
Right.
The story is not complete because there needed to be a conversation between Michael and Tom Hagen about Fredo.
Yeah.
That scene needed to be there. And you can feel his absence in this film.
Mm-hmm.
Duvall, of course, refused to do it because he said they're just doing it for money,
mm-hmm.
and I don't want any part of it. So they wrote him out.
They killed him.
They killed him off, and they wrote him out, and they replaced him
with George Hamilton.
George Hamilton.
Which, I mean, he's fine in the role. It's just unnerving whenever he shows up in a movie because I'm not used to seeing him act. He's the only actor in the world that is famous for not acting.
There's a great moment, unintentionally funny, when they bring in the son, when they bring in Tom Hagen's son, played by John Savage, mm-hmm. and he's now a priest, and Michael says... His father was a great lawyer, and George Hamilton goes, "I know."
I know.
I know. Every 5 minutes I hear this.
It was the most Jewish a mafia consigliere ever got.
Right.
He's a good he right. was a good he was a great lawyer. I know already. Jesus. Hey.
But I'll tell you this, I defend George Hamilton on these grounds, because I think casting him does affect the movie in this way. If you have to get rid of Duvall, which is a bad idea, and you put in George Hamilton, he could sort of symbolize, because in this movie he's Michael is wanting to appear to be completely legitimate.
Mm-hmm.
And so in order to do that, you have to have somebody at your side, your representation, that represents that.
Right.
And the reason Coppola cast George Hamilton was because he wanted the lawyer to be this waspy kind of professional man.
Mm-hmm.
So you look at George Hamilton in this movie, you could imagine this would be the kind of guy that would be the lawyer for like Merrill Lynch. Or Coca-Cola, or something like that. You know, a very corporate,
yes,
waspy...
A swarthy corporate...
Professional man.
Yeah, a lawyer that... Ugh, smarmy.
But there's no personality to this. There's no personality to it. There's no connection between Michael and...
The role could have been filled by literally anyone.
Right. Right.
Like
Robert Duvall.
Yeah. I mean, he could have put Sofia Coppola in that role, and it would have been about the same.
would have been about the same. But but the story between Michael and Tom is just not complete.
Yeah.
It just is not that this you murdered your own brother. And, you know, Tom makes him have to face that.
Mm-hmm.
You have to answer for this. You know, why did you kill my brother? You know, and it, so it always feels like it's just kind of hanging there.
Mm-hmm.
The other problem, the big one, is Sophia.
Oh.
And...
Okay. Now, before we get into her performance, if that's what we're going to call it, I want to ask if you know why there needed to be an incest subplot here.
That is unsettling.
It's unsettling. It's unnecessary. None of that plays into the overarc of the overarching story of the pit. It's there for no reason.
It's probably interesting that you can put in that Sonny had an illegitimate son. That's interesting. That's an interesting part.
Sure.
The problem is,
where are his biological kids, though? How did they? Where did they end up in this family?
Yeah, what happened to the wife?
Yeah, Teresa, right?
Yeah, Sandra.
Sandra. Oh, I know it's Teresa.
I thought Teresa was Tom Hagen's wife.
No, maybe.
But here's the problem I have. The romance in this film is so flat and so dead that you forget about it when it's not sitting there on the screen.
Right, and you want to forget about it when it is sitting on the screen.
Because there's nothing between
them. There's nothing.
And this is the most dangerous thing that this man could possibly do.
Yeah.
Is fool around with the Godfather's daughter. That is the most dangerous thing. I mean,
yeah.
You know, what's the line from the first one? Women are more dangerous than guns. And, you know, and he's fooling around with the Godfather's daughter. That's
day number one.
That's a no-no.
Number two,
yeah.
She's his first cousin.
Right. But you also have to believe that he would rather be with her than Bridget Fonda.
Yeah, which I don't.
Yeah.
I
don't know. There is no attraction between the two of them at all.
There's no chemistry. There is nothing.
And it largely comes from her.
Yeah, I mean, she looks. Every time I watch her in this, I hear Quint in my head going, "She's got those lifeless eyes, those doll's eyes." Just a blank slate. The whole
this is
movie.
This is supposed to be our emotional conduit for the rest of the film because this is the character.
No emotion whatsoever.
This is the character. This is the character who is supposed to represent for Michael at least some form of normalcy and goodness in a sea of people who are just. Greedy and violent.
Right, which would make the end at the opera even more impactful.
Right.
I
there are four actresses who were up for this role. The most famously was Winona Ryder, who dropped out for reasons I still don't know.
She was
But
there was a scheduling conflict.
Something about a scheduling conflict, something about nervous exhaustion, something about that. But she was
Winona Ryder was going through a very rough patch in her personal life.
Well, I mean, but professionally, I mean, she's got
this is coming.
She's got Beetlejuice in 88, she's got Heathers in 89. She's just coming off of Mermaids.
And...
Yeah. Edward Scissorhands and all of this. she's a huge star at the time, mm-hmm. so she was working all the time. I don't know how she would have worked in this movie.
Yeah, see, that's the thing. It's like, when you start going through who was up for it and who was probably going to be playing, it doesn't feel like it would be any better a fit. Just a better actress.
Well, I'll tell you this. I can believe Winona Ryder to be Michael and Kay's daughter before I can believe Sophia.
Well, the nervous energy that she gives off would come directly from Kay.
Right, and the dark beauty would come from Michael.
Right.
I know that two others. One was Annabelle Sciorra and Laura San Giacomo. Laura San Giacomo would have been perfect because she has that that vibe of being sort of dangerous, but also still being a daddy's girl.
Mm.
You know, that kind of energy that the role is calling for. I know Rebecca Schaefer was up for this. Murdered on the day of the audition.
Oh.
This was and her by a stalker.
Mm.
And
I did not know that.
But Paramount Pictures was pushing Coppola to get this thing out by Christmas.
Mm-hmm.
And it wasn't ready.
No.
He wasn't ready. And if he'd had any clout, he probably could have pushed it back a year.
Yeah. And that year probably would have ended up delivering the movie that we got this year. 30 yeah. years later.
Yeah.
That's probably how he would have structured it. I can almost guarantee that a lot of this would have been resolved if he'd have had more time to cut it.
Right.
And reshoot when he was able to get, you know, the right actor.
Yeah. Well, the thing is, and this is the thing, Paramount Pictures was not exactly hurting at this moment.
No.
This was 1990. They had the number one film of the year,
mm-hmm.
which was Ghost. They also had The Hunt for Red October.
Mm-hmm.
And they had the number one movie the previous year, which was Last Crusade.
Yeah.
And so they weren't hurting at all.
No.
They could have waited a year on this.
But they wanted Oscars.
And they wanted that Christmas release. And so they rushed it, and this is the movie we got. But as far as Sophia goes, that was his idea.
Well, yeah, he needed somebody, and he's like, okay, well, why don't you come in and do this until we, you know, as a stand-in, basically. He was going to reshoot her scenes, and then it just went on long enough that he was just like, well, now she's in too much of the movie, I can't recast.
And this is sort of indicative of what Coppola does, because nobody gambles on themselves like Coppola no. does. And he gambled and lost.
Mm-hmm.
Because she cannot act.
No.
And it's right there, because she's supposed, like I say, she's supposed to be our emotional conduit. Right there at that reception, that after party, they hand her a speech. This is supposed to be the moment when she catches the audience, when we are invested in her character. They hand her this speech, and when she opens her mouth, what comes out, Corleone family is dedicated to the rehabilitation of the rebellious Sicily.
She's reading it like a high schooler reading at a presentation or something, that just reading, you know, and then they went down to the river to go to. That's she acts like she's reading. It's
yeah.
She's just not. She has no. She does not have an emotive face.
Yeah.
She doesn't have.
She's beautiful.
Oh, yes. No question about that. But as an actress, she's just a lifeless fish.
That scene where she's sitting on the back porch with Michael, and she's going to be the inheritor of the corporation, and she doesn't, and she's, Dad, I don't understand, you know, and it's just, and you see, she makes Pacino a better actor because you can see how good Pacino is. Yeah. And honestly, it's just the performance is just dead. There's nothing there.
Yeah, Pacino earned his nomination for this.
Yeah,
by working with her.
Coppola came along and he said, "Well, you know, when they were attacking her, they were really attacking me." And I'm like, "No,
no,
no, they're not attacking you. She's terrible."
Right. His job was passable.
Yeah,
even good in many parts. It was just, she's just not an actress. Phenomenally talented writer-director.
That's her wheelhouse.
Magnificent. I actually got to see, finally got to see On the Rocks, which was her.
Yeah, I haven't seen that yet.
It's fun. It's a screwball comedy for contemporary people with far too much money. Which is basically most of her movies.
I like her body of work.
I do too.
I like her voice as a filmmaker.
Marie Antoinette's her best movie.
Marie Antoinette is fantastic. I like The Bling Ring.
I haven't seen that.
I Was Alone and Lacking Somewhere. I really, and Lost in Translation is fun.
Well,
is
Lost
fantastic.
In Translation is brilliant. And the Virgin Suicide is okay too. It's great, but it's
which one?
Virgin Suicides, her first one.
Yeah, I love Virgin Suicides. I like her distinctive voice as a filmmaker.
Mm-hmm.
I just don't like her voice as an actress.
She does not have that as an actress. I mean, her final line. She gets shot.
Dad.
Like, she never. Her face is just blank the whole time.
Yeah.
She doesn't know what she's doing here.
She's delivering it like she got them a cab.
Yeah.
I mean...
like...
Dad?
Cab's here. Dad? Somebody's on the phone for you. Not...
Dad, the car's here.
Not, Dad, I just got shot through the heart after it passed through your shoulder. I mean... She's not an
it's
actress.
It's not like... Look, and it's not like this is like a ninth tier supporting role.
This is a major,
you know,
part.
She's not like some ancillary character. She is dead center of the movie.
Mm-hmm.
And when she leaves the screen, you do not care about you forget about her.
I forget she's even there, and then she comes back, and I'm like, oh yeah, that's part of this.
Yeah,
she's the center of the film, which makes her inconsequential. That much more evident. She is.
And when they're all on the steps and they're all in tears because she's dead, and there's those shots of Kay and Michael and everybody, and you know they're all crying over her. I'm thinking, okay, it's a tragedy,
I do not agree with that. Her death has always gotten me. Not because I was connected to the character, though. It is the general gut feeling of watching a person watch his child die that just dismantles me. And Diane Keaton and Al Pacino in those moments are, in my opinion, magnificent.
They are. But the problem is that I'm following this as in my head, I'm following this as a narrative, and this is a character, the situation, yes, but as to the character, the character does not mean any more to me than anybody, really anybody else
well,
in the
no,
film.
No, and, you know, the character, I mean, by the next day, well, you would have forgotten her impact in the world. That's how slight
Right.
she is in this movie. despite the fact that everything hinges on her. But that whole sequence and situation has, from the first time I saw it until I watched that little bit of it today, magnificent. I think that that silent scream is one of Al Pacino's finest moments on screen.
Until it's not a silent scream.
Well, when he breathes in and screams, I'm like, okay.
Yeah.
But that like, I get it, but that the look on his face, the pain on his face when that's happening, I don't think I've seen Al Pacino in too many better moments.
This is his last really nuanced performance, I think.
Until now. The last couple years, he's gotten back into actually acting, and he stopped shouting at everybody.
The screamy Pacino.
Because he wasn't screamy Pacino in Hunters. He wasn't screamy Pacino in Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. Or in The Irishman. He yelled a little bit in The Irishman, but not as much.
Oh, he yelled in The Irishman.
But not as much as, you know, Scent of a Woman.
Yeah.
For example.
Well, and the other thing is, I think this is a really underrated performance.
Yeah.
Because he's really giving to this performance. He's giving a lot to this performance.
Yeah, he is.
And there's a lot of weight to this character, especially the fact that you can feel the years weighing down on him. Though he does have some ridiculous moments. I thought when he has the stroke is
out the bellow.
Brio!
Out the bellow, you old fuck. You miserable fuck.
Bullshit.
And I realize I don't think anybody says fuck in any Godfather movie except Michael in this one.
I'm trying to think. Does anybody say it? No.
I don't recall
it. I'm thinking back to the first one.
I don't recall it. And it's not until this, and then, you know, Pacino's dropping F-bombs all over the place, and
yeah.
In classic, at that moment, Al Pacino style. Yo, fuck!
Well, and the other thing is, like I say, it's a good performance, and the Academy did not nominate it.
No, and they...
Andy Garcia is the only one from this movie that got a nomination.
I think Talia Shire should have been nominated. Her Connie was better than she had been in... I mean, she was also kind of elevated into being Tom Hagen. And
she's kind of the Lady Macbeth in this. Yeah, she is. There's a lot of Shakespeare in this.
Yes, she is.
I like the role that she plays. I don't think it fits as well into the story as Coppola is hoping it will.
Well, because she was so adamant.
She was so meek. She was the abused wife.
Right. But then when you look, but even by part two, she has not forgiven Michael for killing Carlo.
Right.
Even though...
she becomes the unruly daughter, right. Basically.
So, in these intervening years, it looks like she... Well, after their mother died and after Fredo was killed, I think she started to get closer to him once Kay left at the end of part two. So, I liked seeing her here. But having her there is very counter to what you'd see in Ed. Like, why would she be involved in this when she was directly injured by this, by her husband and her brother being murdered by her brother.
Well, she comes to him at the end of the movie, and I don't at the end of the second one, I don't remember if it's before, I think it's before Fredo is killed, that really touching scene at the end of the first one, she comes to him, and she's at his feet, and she says, I want to take care of you.
Right.
And it's sort of an anointing, I'm with you.
Right.
And you can see in this movie over the years how that small moment has grown into her becoming part of the family. Mm-hmm. And becoming the person that we see in this movie. I think her part is a little unwieldy in this film. I don't think it's focused on as much as it should be.
Right.
But she does a good job.
Right. It's an expanded role, but it's not expanded enough
mm-hmm.
to capture what Shire was trying to do. I really like her in this, with one exception. On the steps, Mary has just been shot. They're all crying. She's crying. And there's that really operatic moment where she takes her shawl up from her shoulders and puts it over her head in this very grandiose, choreographed style. It just looks so hokey that I was embarrassed for Coppola for putting it in there, and embarrassed for her for having to do it, because she looks like she's this overwrought Italian mama. And
it's very theatrical.
Yeah, it's very theatrical, and it doesn't fit in that moment of raw emotion.
I don't know. I'm still... I still think the poison cannoli is just stupid. I really think that is just the dumbest thing. It's like, listen. Now I get it. Now what the movie is saying with this is, this would be a weapon that a woman would use.
Poison.
They always say guns are used to say guns are a man's weapon, poison is a woman's weapon, and it's an interesting addition. But when you see Eli Wallach sitting in the opera box, dancing, bouncing to the music with this cannoli like he's got a hot dog at a Yankees game, it just looks stupid.
Yeah, not only that, but it takes this man an entire opera to eat a goddamn cannoli.
Do you know how long it takes me to eat a cannoli?
It's like three
Probably
bites.
As long as it does to finish this sentence.
Yeah. Like, it was a big cannoli, but still, it doesn't take 2.5 hours to get through. And he doesn't even finish it before the poison kills him.
Man, I would have finished that thing, it would kill me an hour later.
Yeah, right. It would have... I would have forgotten that I even had it.
But when you see the man who's supposed to be the chief architect of all of this sitting in the opera box,
yeah.
And he's bouncing to the music, and he's got this cannoli in his hand, it just looks stupid.
Yeah.
It's like,
yeah.
Now, I like the idea of it,
mm-hmm.
The idea that this is the weapon that Connie would use, but honestly, it doesn't work, and the whole thing, so many problems with this movie. Because the further you get away from Michael, the worse it gets.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
The supporting players in this are so uninteresting.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not interested in any of this. When they go to that, and I don't know if you got this, but a lot of this movie feels very cartoonish. When they go to that meeting, where they're shot up with the helicopter, yeah. I'm thinking back to that meeting that Vito had with the heads of the five families in the first one, in which these were older men in their 60s and 70s, fleshy faces, serious men with experience and old world, they're immigrants, mm-hmm. and you look at them and you can see the years on their face. When you look at the guys in that meeting, they look like they're out of central casting. Mostly because I've seen most of these actors on television, and I'm thinking, these do not look like mobsters. These look like a bunch of investors. Maybe that's my problem. Actually, I don't know, but
I actually kind of saw that as the point, because you see in from one, and then the meetings that they had with the heads of the families with what's his name?
I have no idea.
The Jewish guy in the second one.
Hyman
Roth. Roth. Thank you. And then it gets to here, and they're in Atlantic City, a very cheap glamour, and it shows what the mafia had devolved into. And it started off with, you know, these five families that were, you know, just running vice in the city, making some money, and, you know, to hundreds of millions of dollars.
Kind of like Mo Green.
Yeah, like all of this money has turned them into, gold-plated phonies.
Yeah.
The mob bosses by this point in Godfather Coda or Part 3 or whatever you want to call it now, they've all become Donald Trump. But they actually have money.
Yeah.
Whereas he didn't. He doesn't. But they're supposed to look like investors, because they're not supposed to look like mobsters anymore. Because they feel that they have elevated themselves into high society, and now they have all this money, and now, imagine, the women from Goodfellas,
Yeah.
Everything they wore was double knits and pantsuits, and everything they was cheap and thrown together, and they had bad makeup and bad skin. Imagine those women now with hundreds of millions of dollars instead of just hundreds of thousands of dollars, maybe a couple mil. Now they are the super wealthy, and they still think that gold-plated things are classy.
Yeah.
That's them. That's
they're trashy.
That's the mob now at that point. And when you remember when all these RICO cases and everything were coming up in the 70s and 80s, they didn't look like... You look at John Gotti. John Gotti was more of a...
Which is effectively what these guys are supposed to
right.
be.
Right. He was more of a... He was the Dapper Don. More known for being stylish and flashy than he was for being a mobster, really. That's what I think these were, but that's why they don't look like Tattaglia and
Cuneo Cereggi.
Yeah, and so...
But the problem is that the scene is so cartoonish. You got Michael Corleone in the middle of it. And Michael Corleone is this serious, deep guy with all of these demons, and he's in the middle of this scene that feels very cartoonish. And one thing that bothers me especially is the fact that one of the great things about the first two movies is that when somebody is killed, it happens.
Mm-hmm.
When somebody is killed, it just happens. When they shoot Polly in the back, in the front seat of that car, it's just, it's business as usual.
Pull over, I gotta take a leak.
When, yeah, when they kill who was the mob enforcer? Luca Brasi. It's like it happens all of a sudden.
Right.
Even Sonny's murder happens all of a sudden. But in this movie, there's this build-up, and the scene comes on. There's a quietness to those scenes. When this scene, it's like something out of a Bruckheimer movie.
Yeah.
It's like something out of a Don Simpson, Jerry Bruckheimer movie from the 80s. And it's like, it just, for me, it didn't feel like it belonged in this movie.
Oh. See, I've always kind of liked that sequence. It worked for me as a bold, showy thing from a bold, showy person that would not have even been considered in the generation before. That's why Michael's
and
like...
nobody ever wonders.
Yeah.
And nobody wonders why Don Altobello is trying to get out the door.
I'll talk to him. I'll talk to him. I'll smooth this over. Yeah.
And he's really, really trying to get out that door.
Yeah.
You know? I don't know. I just thought it was ridiculous.
I don't mind that, but again, I don't mind the movie as much as most do, and I still feel that it's 2/3 of a great movie.
It is, and here's the funny thing: when this came out, the reviews were generally positive.
Yeah.
The reviews were generally positive, and they were even, I think Roger Ebert, this is a big misstep in his thinking, even defended Sophia. But the reviews were generally positive. I think a lot of it was because of the hype and because of the buildup, and because nobody really wanted to be negative toward The Godfather, because finally there's a Godfather 3.
Yeah.
Kind of like, you know, when Phantom Menace came out. We didn't want to be negative toward Phantom Menace because finally there's a Star Wars movie again.
Right.
But by the time this came out, everybody was waiting for it because it dropped on Christmas Day. Mm-hmm. And the real problem, I think, with this movie when it dropped is that by the time it came out, Goodfellas had taken everybody's breath away.
Yeah.
And it was winning award after award after award after award. And this just seemed like if Goodfellas was in fifth gear, this felt like it was in second gear. Mm-hmm. It's too long.
Laboring up a hill.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
It is struggling to get where it's going. The narrative, I have seen this movie several times. Mm-hmm. I still can't explain the story of this movie to you. Because
the re-edit clears up the main thrust.
The re-edit
of the story.
Clears up a lot of stuff, but that stuff at the end, with when you find that when the ball drops, when the shoe drops, and you find out the Immobiliari and the church and everybody's conspiring against him and all of this stuff, and they start explaining. I had to find that stuff out afterwards.
Yeah, it starts to fall apart. I'm with you on that. I've seen this probably a dozen times. I've seen this less than I have the other ones, but I've still seen this a hefty amount of times, more than most. And yeah, the it took me 3 or 4 or 5 times to really understand the core of what the story was, and then it still loses me at the end. It just becomes too convoluted without any explanation.
It's like a 40-minute scene. It's going in about 8 different directions, and I don't care about any of it. All I know is they're trying to kill Michael. And they're trying to wrap all of this up, and there's a lot of these characters. They're running around in the dark. They're killing each other, and they're trying to tie up the thing with the Vatican. They're trying to tie up the thing with the Mobiliari. They're doing this and this. I remember the end of Goodfellas. I knew exactly what was happening at the end of Goodfellas.
Oh, yeah.
He was on drugs. He was losing all of his friends.
And his mind.
And he was losing his mind. I got it.
Yeah.
Here, it's just, like I say, it's in first gear, and it's like, I don't care what's happening anymore. You know?
Right. There's, again, a lot of things could have been solved with more time and a delayed start to the shoot so that they could get an actress in the role of Mary Corleone.
Right, and get Robert Duvall in.
Right, if possible. But, yeah, so let's talk about the end. So, in the original version, it kind of fades up, and you see Michael Corleone, an old man in a chair with two puppies playing. It's like at a distance. Cuts to him.
No. You see Al Pacino in a chair wearing a pizza on his face. Mm. This terrible makeup job.
Regardless, he puts on sunglasses, and then it cuts back to the longer shot, and you see him slump, and he falls out of the chair. You see him die.
Yeah.
But in the recut,
as I said in my review, it mercifully fades out before the dog pees on his hat. Because I have dogs. I know what he's about to do, because I'm watching that dog head toward that hat.
Yeah, in about 5 minutes, they're going to go, well, nobody's coming for him, and start eating him.
Yeah.
They're going to start licking the salt off of him, and then, you know, but the re-edit cuts in on him. He clumsily puts on his sunglasses, which I always kind of thought was a really, really good physical gesture from him. The way that he's having trouble getting the sunglasses on is very much, you can tell that he's in his late 80s, early 90s. Like,
he's got those infirmities.
Right. And you see him with the sunglasses, and then it cuts to a quote saying,
when a
Sicilian wishes you senta anni, their wish, it means for long life, and a Sicilian never forgets. I don't know what this is. I don't know what this means.
Okay.
I understand what the sentence means, but I don't understand.
There's a BBC article. An article that was on BBC.com. This is how they explain it. Coppola adds a text at the end which says, when the Sicilians wish you Sentani, yeah, it means for a long life, and a Sicilian never forgets. Michael is doomed to a long life of remembering. Godfather Coda restores the darker vision, one element that creates a jolt even when he couldn't have seen coming. I know what he's trying to do. He's trying to say Michael didn't die, so he is doomed to live with these memories, these demons, until the inevitable happens. And he's saying basically that in the original, his death kind of lets him off the hook. I get it, but it's so clumsily done.
Yeah, it's not very clear at all. There's no that kind of an ending. You would almost feel needs a little bit more.
I would almost have said reshoot it.
Yeah.
Because Pacino's still around. He's 30 years older. You get somebody's villa and you can shoot an ending without that cheese ball makeup. Mm-hmm. And you can just, you know, he puts on the glasses and then it fades out. If you shot a new ending, I thought that might work.
Yeah.
You know, it might work a little
better. Yeah, when they said it's ending, I was expecting, well, I don't know what I was expecting.
That's what I was expecting. I was expecting something, you know, a new shot, like Lucas would do, or something like that, or, you know,
When you say a new ending, you expect it to be slightly more than just shaving off 2 seconds of the end and putting in some text. That's not a new ending.
And
it's not a new beginning when it's a new beginning when you recut and put one thing that you had later in the beginning. Technically, that's a new place for the movie to start. It's a new beginning, but it's not a new beginning. It's like,
yeah, but when you cut the ending, when you've done such a good job of rearranging the scenes at the beginning,
yeah,
so that you've got all of this, so that you've got a clearer path to the story being told. Right. That works. Yeah. This ending, it needed to be redone.
Right.
It really needed to be redone.
It's trying to be philosophical in a movie that was entirely, from beginning to end, literal. With no nuance except Al Pacino's performance. Like, there's no...
It isn't it...
Subtlety.
You know what I find really interesting is that he didn't get a nomination for this... But he got a nomination for Dick Tracy. Yeah. Another shouty performance.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I mean, it's a flawed movie. I know I've bashed it so much, but his performance does work. I think it's right at the beginning you can feel that there are problems. And that he's trying to get past this legacy of being this gangster. Mm-hmm. When he's standing at the podium and he's having this board meeting, this meeting with the reporters.
Yeah.
He's trying to sound like a legitimate businessman. But it's Michael Corleone.
Yeah.
This is a man who killed, gunned down a police captain and a mob boss, and a feared mob boss.
Right.
In
a restaurant.
In a public place, And I'm going to tell you there is a scene in the movie that is really confusing, which just shouldn't be surprising because it involves Sophia. There's a scene where they're in Sicily and she's looking at a picture of Apollonia. Mm-hmm. And I have no idea what that scene is supposed to be because what I pulled from it, I thought, okay, is she Apollonia's daughter? Because I was like...
No, they just didn't know about her.
I don't know. Her performance is so flat and her face is so unremarkable that I mean, as far as acting goes, I had no idea what that was supposed to be.
Yeah, it's just... It's regrettable.
And I sit there and I watch this film and I realize when they get to Sicily how long I've got to go for the rest of this movie.
Once they get to Sicily... there are parts that are quite good. Mm-hmm. But there are more parts that I don't really know why they're there. And once we get to Cavalleria Rusticana,
the last time I heard the name of that opera, it was spoken by Porky Pig.
Oh, that must have taken 20 minutes.
Well,
Cavalleria. Yeah, no.
But I'm telling you, I got to ask you this. What do you think about the scene where Vincent becomes the Don?
Because
there's a scene where
it's dumb. It looks awful.
And it happens kind of quickly.
Yeah, it just kind of happens. And it's like, his whole training and everything should have been closer to the center of the movie. But yeah. It seems like he's like, all right, we'll see if we can find a place for you. And then all of a sudden he's like his number two, and then he takes over. It's like, wait, he's only been learning from you for like a month and a half. How is he qualified now?
Pacino stands up and he says, you know, from now on you will call yourself Vincent Corleone. But he has the demeanor when he says it of a guy who is late for an appointment. Yeah.
Well, like, he leaves the room with Connie like he is going like he has another meeting. Like he had to be there for this, but he had to just put in his appearance and say a couple of things and then he had to go. Like,
and he gives him his generals,
his capos.
His generals. They do the thing where he sits in the chair and he crosses his leg and they kiss his hand and say, Don Corleone. And I'm thinking to myself, I should feel more impact from this.
Yeah, the passing of the torch felt more like one of the legs at the Olympics instead of lighting it in the stadium, you know? It's just another thing.
It felt more like a step than a leap.
Right.
But it's just an illustration of how unfocused this movie is, because there's so much going on and so many things. It needed even more editing. Mm-hmm. I mean, a lot of stuff. Yeah. And it needed to be, you know, characters, side characters, plots that are cut out. The whole Bridget Fonda thing, she drops out
she
of the movie like
vanishes.
That. I mean,
after the scene after the home invasion scene, she's just gone.
You know where Joey Zaza sends the two worst assassins? These guys couldn't steal a loaf of bread.
Yeah,
I mean,
no, they... yeah, it's...
Leia had an easier time getting into Jabba's palace than they did getting into his apartment.
Yeah, I can still sit and enjoy the movie, but yes, it's kind of a hot mess, and
also it kind of, and I said this in my review, it really doesn't add a whole lot that's new.
Mm-mm.
Because it's the same story as the second one, essentially. In that you've got
merged
Michael
with
trying
the,
merged to...
with the plot from the first film.
Right. Because you got Michael trying to make the family legitimate, but you've got all these guys around them that are just not wanting that to happen. Right. And you got the old guard, you know, the old mobsters not liking what he's doing. And not allowing him, and also his name, mm-hmm. Corleone, is not allowing him to do that. And so, if you pared this down, this movie could have easily been an hour and 45 minutes long. If you pared it down just to the immediate family and what's going on with Michael internally, you know, and trying to make amends with Kay and trying to make amends with his son and trying to make amends with Tom Hagen.
Yeah.
You know, a much smaller film that really is a coda.
Mm-hmm.
But instead they're trying to make this an epic, and this really has nowhere to go. Because the first movie was about his rise to power. The second film was about the downfall, the evil that he left himself to do. And there's no really place for
this
to go.
This is supposed to be a redemption story, but how does a man like that redeem himself?
Right.
Like,
and the answer is,
he doesn't. It's a sad movie.
But,
it's still sad. It's decent, but I don't think it deserves the hate, but...
There's a critic on Ebert.com who had a great take on it. He said, it's the great what-if movie. Mm-hmm. You know, what if Coppola had been given the time to work it out? What if he had gotten the Mary part right? What if he had gotten Duvall? What if he had been able to just do the film that he wanted to do? Mm-hmm. You can see all of that in here.
That's what makes the movie tragic. Not the death of Mary, but the fact that you can see that this should have been much better.
Right.
There are scenes within this that are just like, if there were only more of those.
Yeah.
Like,
Trim the fat and, you know, really honestly make it a coda.
It's a frustrating film, but
yeah,
you know, the re-edit improves it.
Mm-hmm. It's not perfect. No.
It's not the first two,
but it improves it.
So what do we have? What do we have coming up at the beginning of the year?
Second day of the year, January 2nd, Doug and I are going to do a live stream. We're going to try it. We've never done this before. We're going to do a live stream. So please show up on our YouTube channel. This will be Saturday, January 2nd, 2021, which sounds odd to say. And based on the way 2020 went, a relief to say. So stop by. We're going to talk about the movie year of 2020, the state of the movies, the state of the movie industry, and also the screeners and the films that we saw. Because I'll be honest with you, it's been such a crummy year at the movies and such a weird year at the movies. I can't make a 10 best list.
I have no idea. Yeah, I got nothing.
It's been the best three-star movie. It's been the best three-star year I've ever had.
Yeah, yeah. And very little has knocked me out. But we'll talk about that. And the week after that...
What do we get after that?
The week after that is my pick. My first pick of the year is a double bill. It's Yojimbo and Sanjuro.
Yay!
Because
there were a little bit of that, little bit of both in The Mandalorian this past season,
and you know, I've been wanting to get to them for a while, and it was that or Lady Snowblood, and I didn't want to have to make you watch another chop 'em up samurai series like last year. Like the biggest.
Speaking of chopping them up, the movie that we're going to talk about after that, we're going to chop up Star Trek the Motion Picture. Mm-hmm. We're going to have another fire sale review. These are the things we do every once in a while, in which we take a movie that was a box office success, a troubled box office success, and kind of go through it little by little.
Right. It'll be our third one after.
Star Trek II, Superman II, and
Return of the Jedi.
Return of the Jedi.
Our first one, yeah. So, we have some interesting things coming up. We still have a lot of the upcoming year up in the air. We have quite a number of things in the immediate future still up in the air. We'll let you know what's coming up as we solidify those. You can find all of our back episodes at the podbaydoorspodcast.wordpress.com. You can listen to us on iTunes and YouTube. Hit the like, subscribe, and enable the notifications. There, hit us up on Twitter at pod_bay. Same handle at Patreon. And we thank you so very much for listening, and the Pod Bay doors are now closed.
The mission has been completed.
Speak softly, love, and hold me warm against your heart. I feel your words, the tender trembling moments start. We're in a world, our very own, sharing a love that only few have ever known. Wine-colored days warmed by the sun, deep velvet nights when we are one. Speak softly, love, so no one hears us but the sky. The vows of love we make will live until we die. My life is yours, and all because you came into my world with love. So softly, love. So